Josiah's brother, or Mr. Underwood.
Yeah, yeah.
I've hired help tonight. And by hired help, I mean he's not going to be here alone. Alan's going to help come help sing a couple. We even coordinated our outfits, as you can see.
That was not on purpose.
No, it was. I saw his Snapchat, and I said, I'm going to wear a purple shirt, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Start off with a bang. I'm kind of homesick for a country.
Yeah.
To which I've never been before.
Damn.
No sad goodbyes will e'er be spoken. For time won't matter anymore. Beulah land, I'm longing for you.
Yeah.
And someday on me I'll stand where my home shall be eternal.
Bless him, Lord.
I thought he was giving me the second verse. I was like, that's the name.
I remember when I'm down there.
Bafe. I'm looking.
Is it?
Just a few.
Just a few.
Oh.
More days to labor. And I'll take my head. I knew that song 3 days ago. For me.
Whatever you want to
do. Alan was not prepared for this.
I was not. There's no practice to this. This is just me practicing sitting down there.
There's a man in here that I'm looking for, said the man. Could find no room at the door, so they lowered him down. Stretch your bed, and Jesus looked at him and said, all your sins are gone now. Go this day, take up your bed, and go your way. As he walked through the crowd, I heard him declare, I can tell you all, there's a man in there. There's a man in here who turns water wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind. He gives back life to the one that's dead, and he fed 5,000 with 7 loaves of bread. There's a man in here who makes demons flee. He makes cripples walk and has chosen even me. He lives in my heart, and I have no fear. I'm a disciples cried as the ship was tossed from side to side. So they woke him up as the waves dashed high and said, don't you care that we're about to die? He said, peace be still. And the waves obeyed. He said, they saw that the sea was calm and clear. They said, thank you, God. There's a man in here. There's a man in here who turns water to wine, and he walks on the water and gives sight to the blind. He gives back life to the one that's dead, and he fed 5,000 with 7 loaves of bread. There's a man in here who makes demons flee. He makes cripples walk and has chosen even me. He lives in my heart, and I have no fear. I'm a better man, because there's a man in here.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen,
bro.
You got it just like that. Like that. The church was so full. So full, yeah, that they had to cut a hole in the roof and let him down the road.
Amen.
He had such a desire to be healed. That's great,
amen. Amen,
bro.
If we can get that kind of feeling out of people nowadays.
Amen, bro.
Couldn't get in the house of the Lord. They let him down through the roof of the road. They healed him.
Right. Amen, bro.
I think that's how.
Amen. Good.
Lord's good to us.
Yes, he is. Amen.
Where he is.
He's too good to us.
Amen, brother.
By faith, through grace.
Amen.
We're saved.
Amen.
I love the Lord. He's been too good to me. I tell you that. I'm not worth it, but he thought I was.
Amen.
He loved me so much. He went and died upon the cross.
That's right.
Shed his blood. There's only one way you can get to heaven.
Amen.
You Christians know what it is. It's through and by the blood of our Savior Jesus
Christ. That's right.
Amen.
No
Amen.
Other way. They might come out with something. They say there's a lot of way to heaven. I'll have to disagree with them. But my Bible tells me there is one way
Amen.
To get to heaven.
Amen.
That's to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins.
That's right.
He'll save you. He's a just God.
Amen.
He'll chastise you too. I'm glad of that. Y'all pray. I got a wife. Not doing too good. Y'all pray for her. I just tell them, Dreamer, my wife used to live about 2 or 3 miles up Goose Creek here. That's what we call it, Goose Creek. Up across Pig Iron Mountain, if you know where I'm talking about. And her granddad owned a farm over there. She walked down there to school every day. Every day. Mud was about that deep, but still, yeah, she walked down there. So I know this territory pretty well. Me and Frank Parsons used to go over hunt here all the time, Goose Creek here. But anyhow, pray for me and my family.
Bless you. Amen. Bless your heart, bro.
Pray for the lost.
Bless you, bro.
Amen.
Amen.
Dad's all the time telling me that I need to talk more between my sons.
That's what my wife tells me.
I made the joke that I'm not much of a talker, but that's weird considering that I talk for a living. I teach people. I literally talk for 7 hours a day. But it's still difficult. I was listening to a podcast of one of the guys who he wrote this next song I'm about to sing, and he said that in Christian music is the one of the only genres of music where what happens in between the songs is more important than what's happening during the song.
Yeah.
Because what happens in between the songs is the ministry. So I'm still working on that, but I'm trying to get better.
Bless you,
bless you, bro.
But this song's called "O Me of Little Faith." It's the first song I ever really sang in public. Until I was 16, I didn't really sing in public because it's something somebody told me once upon a time. But I slowly recovered from that, and here I am now.
Bless you, brother.
Oh, me of little faith, can't seem to see my way out of this storm I'm in. The doubt and waves are crashing in, and down to my last mustard seed. God help, oh, me of little faith.
Bless you, Lord. That's good, sir.
Oh, me of little hope, what I would give to know the answers waiting on the other side of the pain and the tears I've cried. At the end of a worn out road, God help all me of little
Lord. Yeah, bless the Lord.
Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief, cause trust and fear are fighting, and I'm somewhere in between. The fumbling fool I am, I'll never understand how you, oh God, have been this grace, could love only a little faith.
Amen, buddy, that's good stuff.
Only of little peace, this world won't leave me be, spinning out of my control. Troubled times, troubled soul, help me fix my eyes on me. God help, oh me of little peace.
Yes, yeah.
Oh me of little love, a lonely life in the middle of. I see your face is racing on. I think I find it, then it's gone. But you fill my empty cup. God help, oh me of little love.
Yeah.
Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief, cause trust and fear are fighting somewhere in between. The fumbling fool I am, I'll never understand. Oh God, of in this grace, love only a little faith.
Good stuff, bro. Amen. Amen.
Oh me of little strength, I can't bear this heavy weight. It's pressing down on my shoulders now. It took a while, but I'm finding out. Blessed are the ones so weak. God help, oh me of little strength.
Yeah.
Oh me, little hope. Oh me, little peace. Oh me, little love. Oh me, little strength. The fumbling fool I am, I'll never really understand. You, oh God, have been this grace. Love, oh me, a little faith.
Yeah.
Brian don't like talking in between them, but I am more than happy to talk for a minute. If y'all didn't realize, I've been pretty blessed in the last week. Yeah. Got a little baby girl back here with us.
Amen.
You know, I'm on a volunteer fire department. I've ran down the road, lights and sirens blaring on our way to whatever. Heart's sitting there thumping. Don't think it's ever thumped that quick, though, going down the interstate to a hospital.
Yeah. Bless you, brother.
You know, it's a blessing, and we were sitting there, and that little baby was born, and I sat there and got to watch it, and they laid her up on my wife's chest there, and she starts crying. I'm doing all right. I'm holding it together. I've been a crybaby all day, and Neil, that dark-haired fella back there sitting there messing with everything, waving, had to text me. He was like, welcome to the dad club, and I realized for a moment how much God loves me, because I love that little girl to death, and the love I have for her is just a drop in the bucket of the amount he has for me.
That's right.
And I sat there, and my wife looks over at me. She's like, you okay? Yeah. You sure? Yeah. I stand up, and I go to walk towards her, and I fell. I fell. I hit that floor. I mean, I was on my knees sobbing. You could have mopped the floor. I mean, it was awful. I don't think I've ever cried that hard. And I was sitting there just praising God. I mean, he given me something amazing. My wife was healthy. Yeah. She was doing good. My little girl was healthy and doing good. I finally got it together. I was like, all right, I can get up. I got up, and just as I came over that little handrail, I seen my little girl staring at me. Nope! Right back down. I started praising him again. One of the nurses spoke up. She was like, those happy tears? Yeah! I mean, I couldn't get it together. Finally, I got it together there a little bit, and we'd be driving home or something still now. I mean, 6 days later, just we'd be sitting there driving down the road. A song would come on. I'm sitting there, I gotta drive. I mean, it just, he's amazing. And the fact that we were in the hospital there, before I jumped too far ahead, we were in the hospital. out of all the diapers that needed changed, I done all but one. And the only reason I didn't do that one was because my wife told me she wanted to. You know, I take pride in being able to clean up my little girl and taking care of her. And, you know, it's amazing to know that there's God there that loves to clean up my messes too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, he takes care of all of them, not just the majority. You know, I love that little girl to death, but, I mean, it's so amazing knowing that there's a God that watches over all three of us.
Yeah.
You know, that's my world sitting right there in that pew. And he watches over all three of us, and I couldn't thank him more.
Amen. Bless you.
It's thinking of the love of God. This is what this song's about.
I've seen him stumble and fall time and time again. And I've heard your cry as you crawl, 'cause you're too weak to stand. You may doubt you deserve me now, but let me tell you, child. Yesterday I loved you.
Amen.
Today I love you still. And ask me tomorrow how long I love you. Tell you I always will.
Amen.
I'll tell you I always will.
Amen.
I see you hold it together, do it without help. When will you understand you aren't by yourself?
Right.
May doubt you deserve me now, but let me tell you, child. Yesterday I loved you, today I love you still.
Yeah.
Ask me tomorrow how long I love you, I'll tell you I always will.
Yeah, amen.
Hey.
So long, thought you were long gone, but you were always there with arms wide open. I ran for so long, thought you were long gone, but you were always there. Yesterday you loved me, today you love me still. When I asked how long you loved me, you told me you always will.
Yeah, I get all of
you. You told me you always will.
That's good saying.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Bless you. I love that.
I think I got one.
One more?
I'm pretty sure you do. I have the words for you.
I didn't know that one, so.
I have the words for all. That's what I'm saying. I have the words.
That was good, bro.
Here, I'm gonna switch your side.
Just here, you can carry that. And I'm skipping the second verse because it's a long song. You know.
We'll go with it. I'll see.
Yeah, you do.
We'll try it.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my strength, my stand. This cornerstone. This solid ground, burn through the fiercest doubt and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when snares are still and striving seems. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Love and righteousness. stands in victory. Sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine. Even the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death.
Amen.
This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath,
amen.
Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home.
Good stuff.
We'll take advantage of Bryant being here with us. He's playing guitar for us here. This was a friend of ours wrote this called When I See Jesus, if I can remember the tune to it. This is Adam Hager's the fellow's name that wrote this, and he wrote it when he said he was listening to people talk, and he said, you hear the name of God used, you hear the name of Jesus, you hear Lord, and people don't even know what they're talking about,
yeah.
Who they're talking about.
Yeah.
He said, this is what it means when I hear Jesus, or when I say Jesus. When the world hears me talking, I want it to be plain that your name means more to me, more than just a careless word. I want to make sure when it's heard, they know that I mean just what I say. When I say Jesus, I mean my Savior. When I say Lord, I mean the one who saved my soul. And God my Father, well, he's really my Father. And he had mercy on my sinful soul. People spend their whole life looking for a joy they'll never find, a peace that only you could ever give. But they'd only stop and listen to the word they really say, they would find your name's the only way. When I say Jesus, I mean my Savior. When I say Lord, I mean the one who saved my soul. And God my Father, well, he's really my Father. And he had mercy on my sinful soul. When I think about your sacrifice, I remember that I'm free.
That's right.
You paid the price and I'll never be the same. So I'm reminded at your name, I'm the reason that you came. And telling the world will be my highest aim. When I say Jesus, I mean your Savior. When I say Lord, he's the one who will save your soul. And God my Father, he'll be your Father too. Before you found him, he He already knew you.
That's right. Bless the Lord.
Before you found him, he already knew you.
That's right. Amen. Good, yeah.
The world doesn't even know who they're talking about.
That's
you
right.
Hear the name of Jesus
Amen.
Several times through the day, and when somebody says that they don't know who they're talking about, hey, that's my Savior.
That's right.
The God of heaven, they'll use Lord,
Amen.
You know, in his name in vain. They never think about who they're talking about.
That's
what
right.
does his name mean to you? I hope it means a whole lot more than what they think it does.
Right.
Amen.
It's a lot.
Jerry, you sang a song that I can't remember the name of now, but Herman used to sing occasionally. What is that song?
Wasn't the nails that held him there?
Yeah, you sang that.
Yeah, go on. If you got testimony, my Lord, it's the Lord's time. We
said that they've, they've made God a slang now. It's a slang
right.
word. But I love the song you sung about the faith, because I was thinking about, I've been very physical my whole life, and you think about that gentleman that they put down through the roof. It took 4, 5, 6 guys to carry him somehow upstairs. Somehow, talk about faith. Those are the cats.
Yeah.
That said, you know what? We're going to get to Jesus somehow. We don't care.
Yeah. Right.
This is dead weight. And these guys had to somehow get up there. And then faith is just amazing. So I used it a while back. Got stopped by a trooper, and not speed, easily speed. But he come up, and this guy was so scared that he got to my vehicle, or car guy. But anyways, he got to the poster, and he wouldn't get any closer to me. And I showed him my gun permit, and I'm talking to him. He said, "No, I'm speeding by." We go through the whole thing, and Holy Spirit the whole time saying, "Pray for him. Pray for him." And so he went back, came back, gave me all my paperwork, just gave me a warning. But I said, "Sir, do you mind if I pray for you?" And he stepped forward then. And I grabbed his hand, and I just started praying for him. And I know that the Lord just had him stop me so that I could pray for him.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I was so crushed. You talk about that faith. I couldn't drive. I sat there because Holy Spirit hit my car so heavy, I just sit there crying. You know, to realize what just happened, because Lord worked that all out, that I was going too fast. This guy stopped me to pray for him, so I went down to my friend's house, and I'm still crying. And he said, "What is it?" And I told him, and he got all excited. Let's pray for the guy. You know, so it's amazing the
Amen.
Faith and how we just have
yeah.
it. And just
yeah,
Amen.
It's just, it's amazing.
Bless.
Amen. Amen.
They got yeah. a ticket, too.
Amen. Yeah, the Lord, he's in control.
Yeah. Yes.
This song Joe mentioned here, it wasn't the nails. I like this song as well, and I'll try to sing the other two, Joyce, if my brain can remember it. I'm getting old, you know. This song said it wasn't the nails. So oft I thought of Calvary, where Jesus bled and died. There on a cross, a rugged cross, my Lord was crucified. I thought about those rusty nails that scarred his hands and feet. What wondrous love, what a sacrifice, he did it all for me.
That's right.
Not for crimes that I had done, they nailed him to a tree. But for his loving mercy, he gave his life for me.
Yeah.
Hanging there between two thieves, no love could e'er compare. But it wasn't those old rusty nails that held my Savior there. 10,000 angels all hovered round. They would have come and taken him down. Remove those nails with loving care. But it wasn't the nails that held him there. They thought that he was bound fast, nailed there in disgrace. Didn't know the King of Glory had come to take my place.
Yeah.
Didn't know that his compassion, his love beyond compare, was the nails, the only nails that held my Savior there. 10,000 angels all hovered round. They would have come and taken him down. Remove those nails with loving care. But it wasn't the nails that held him there.
That's right.
And it wasn't the nails that held him
there.
He didn't have to go, but he went willingly
because
he loved you and me. Man, I really like that song. And I'm going to try to sing this last. If you got testimony, mind the Lord, I got to find the words if I can, because they're probably not in my brain.
I got it's worse as you get older, bro.
I'm in trouble then. Anybody got testimony? I'm going to have to try to pull them out of my brain. They're tiny. I do have glasses for that. And Joyce, anytime I'm in service with Joyce, I can always count on Joyce asking me to sing this song. But it's a good one.
Once I wandered in sin's black night, and there was no way I could make my wrongs right. Then that old accuser to the Lord did cry. He is a sinner, and now he must die. Then I heard a voice saying, Father, I'll go, and I'll pay his sin debt in Calvary's flow. I'll bear in my body the marks of the cross to save that child who is sin sick and lost. Yeah. And it's still the blood,
yes,
that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within. And from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea, it is still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Now there are those who rely on the works that they do, and some men count on the times they pray through. Oh, but when the battle is over and my last song is sung, I'll go home through the blood,
yes,
of my Father's, yes, precious Son.
Yes.
And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within. And from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea, it is still the blood of Jesus,
yes,
that brings victory to me.
Amen. Still the blood. It'll always be the blood.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Anybody else have a testimony tonight before Brother Fred comes to preach? If you do, my Lord.
Amen.
Everybody gets all excited about what time it is. That's the Lord's time.
That's all right.
All right. Nothing else. Come on, brother. Amen. Brother Fred Christian, do it at your birthday.
Amen. Amen. Well, I just want to say how much I've enjoyed the service tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Luke chapter 15, if you have your Bibles, you turn there. Hello, Charlie. I didn't see you there. Amen. You were sitting right beside me, but I didn't see you. But it's good to see you this evening. Now, I get that same kind of complaint from my wife. She says I don't talk enough before I preach. And I was a pastor at the Bell Creek Baptist Church for 5 years over in I used to joke about being the Tri-County area. We're right in a little sliver there, Fayette and Nicholas and Kanawha County, Clay and Kanawha County. And I was asked to come preach a meeting in Summersville, West Virginia. So I went up to preach for Brother Bud Truman in Summersville. And it's about a 27-mile drive from Bell Creek Baptist there at Dixie all the way over to Summersville. And I came home one night and I got home. She said, how'd you get home so early? And I said, well, I just went over and preached, came home. She said, I bet you didn't even stop to say hi. Amen. So hi, amen. And that's kind of the way I am. I got one thing on my mind when I get in the pulpit, and that's preaching the gospel. And sometimes I tell folks I got a one-track mind, and half of that's off the rail, amen. So, but it's good to be here in the house of the Lord. I just want to stop long enough to say how much I appreciate the singing, amen, bro. Y'all did a great job. That last song that you sang, we sang that in a cantata in our church, and there were people that absolutely loved that song. They requested by our choir all the time, and boy, I tell you, that was great singing. I appreciate it, and I appreciate you, Brother Jalis. I want to say, I don't know if I've expressed it enough, but I want to thank Brother Jeff. Brother Jeff, thank you for having me.
Amen.
Come and preach this meeting. You know, I've been at Big Baldwin 24 years, and I preached in a lot of churches. And I heard about you and your ministry here. And I guess you've been here about 25 years, and I've been at Big Baldwin 24 years. So we started close to the same time. And I know you've been faithful here in this work, and I appreciate the ministry that you've had here. I've heard about you, and I've seen you at those fellowship meetings. I don't go to too many of them, but just thank you. Thank you for the opportunity you give me to be here. Luke chapter 15. I'm going to read a lot of scripture tonight. And my pastor always taught me, if you don't have much of a message, read a lot of scripture. Amen. Let's all stand in reverence to the reading of God's word. I'll start in verse 1. Read quite a good portion of this chapter. It says, "Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle, and sweep the house, and seek diligently till she find it? And when she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, Rejoice with me, for I found a piece which I had lost. And likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the holy angels, in the presence of the angels of God, over one sinner that repented. And he said, A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Give me the portion of goods that falleth to me, and he divideth unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, How many hired servants of my father have I have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, Bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. Now notice verse 24, For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry.
Yeah.
Now I want to preach to you for just a little while on this subject. Why men are lost. Amen. Men are lost.
Amen.
Let's bow forward and pray. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity and the privilege you've given us to be here. Thank you for those who gathered here in this place tonight. And I pray now that you bless the word. Lord, as I stand here, Lord, I confess my need of you. I confess, God, that I can't do anything without you. I confess, Lord, that I'm weak, but I know you're strong. You said when I'd be weak enough, you'd be strong enough, Father. And I pray now that you'd fill me with the Holy Spirit. I pray, God, that you'd anoint me fresh for this time of service. I pray that you'd give me an unction, the Holy One. And Lord God, I ask you tonight to do what only you can do. I pray that there's somebody here tonight that's lost. God, that you'd save them. They wouldn't spend one more night out in sin. That today would be the day of salvation. They'd come and receive you. Thank you for all that you do and everything you give. I pray and ask it in Jesus' name for his sake. And amen. Amen. Be seated, please. Now, I think we need to pay attention to the fact that sinners were attracted to Jesus. Now, when you look at that, let me read you the verse. Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. Now, think about that for a moment. I wonder what that has to say about the church today. I mean, when you look at that, sinners were attracted to Jesus. Now, and they didn't come because he catered to them. And they didn't come because he compromised his message.
Right.
And they didn't come because of any other thing other than he cared for them. He cared for them, and he understood their needs. And you'll find if you read that he tried to help them. And you see, the Savior was criticized by the Pharisees because he received sinners. But the Pharisees criticized sinners and repelled them. And you see, the difference is the Pharisees had no love for lost souls. And you know, I always believe that when you read these three parables, now I've preached on them individually through the years, and I probably preached more sermons on the parable of the prodigal son than maybe any other preacher. I think I've called it through the years the inexhaustible parable, and I've preached from it time and time again. I don't think you can ever get everything there is out of it. But I've always believed in my heart that these three parables were connected because there's some similarities that run through them. Now, in every case, you'll find that something is lost. And then you find that something is found. And the third thing you find is there was rejoicing.
Right.
Amen. And as you look at it, I think that's what I talked to you a little bit about the first night of the meeting. I think when the lost is found, there's time to rejoice.
Amen. Amen.
Now, you're going to notice that it says, and I read the text that you talk about, there's rejoicing over one sinner that repenteth, more than the 99 that need no repentance. He said the second time that there's rejoicing in heaven. Now, I've heard people say the angels in heaven were rejoicing in heaven, but if there's rejoicing in heaven, the Bible says, every time somebody gets saved. Now, I'm going to tell you, I believe there was time when God's people need to rejoice. It's when the lost is found.
Amen. Amen.
I talked about that on the first night of the meeting. And if you want to get in tune with heaven, if somebody gets saved, if the lost is found, and you rejoice, I'll tell you what, you're in tune with what's going on over on the other side.
Amen. That's right.
But as you look at this, I believe as you look at all three of these parables, if you look at them as a unit, you'll find that they point us to something because every one of them was given it in response to the accusation that Jesus receiveth sinners and eateth with them. Now, when you look at that, they were criticizing him, and he said, well, here's what I got to say to you. And I believe when you put them together, you get a picture of why men are lost. Now, I'm going to use these three parables tonight, and I want to give you some things that I hope will be a blessing to you. I hope if you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, if you're lost and you say, well, preacher, I'm lost and I've been thinking about being saved. Well, I'll tell you, tonight should be the night that you come to Christ. Amen.
Amen.
But as you look at it, let me say, number one, you see the parable of the lost sheep. Now, as you look at the parable of the lost sheep, I believe it teaches us that some men are ignorantly lost. Now, when you look at that, I want to show you three things from that little parable. First of all, I want you to see straying sheep. Now, when you look at, you know, that's something that speaks to all of humanity.
I mean, the Bible says all we like sheep have gone astray and turned everyone to his wicked way. And when it comes right down to it, before we ever got saved, we were just like sheep straying away from the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the condition of all of us before we got saved. Now, there are a lot of us that we have a picture in our mind and we think about, well, what is he, you know, little white sheep? And, you know, it just can gender something. But when you look at what Jesus had to say and comparing us to sheep, that you'll find if you look at sheep that it wasn't all that a romantic picture. Because when you talk about sheep, you'll find that, number one, that sheep were dumb. Amen. I mean, sheep had to be led. And not only that, they had no sense of direction. And they were defenseless. They would often go and they'd wander away and get cast. And that means they'd lay down on their side and they couldn't get up. And all of a sudden that they'd roll over on their back and they would lay there and die if somebody didn't come along and find them in that condition. But when I say that, I want you to understand that a sheep, when it strays away and gets out in the wilderness by itself, it has no sense of direction. It can't find its way home. Now, and if you would for just a moment, because sheep are dumb, I'd like to say to you that it talks about the condition of men being ignorantly lost. Now, what do you mean, preacher? Well, don't get defenseless when I say that, because I'm going to say this. There was a time in my life when I was ignorantly lost. There was a time in my life when I didn't know the way home.
Right.
There was a time in my life at the age of 20. Now, let me give you a word of testimony for just a moment. I didn't get saved until I was 20 years old. I was not raised in a Christian home. When I got saved, I didn't have a Christian mommy or a Christian daddy. I didn't have anybody in my immediate family that knew Jesus Christ as their Savior. You don't know what a blessing it is to have somebody in your family that knows Jesus Christ,
amen,
and somebody that can point you in the right direction. I didn't know any. I mean, at the age of 20, I'd never been in church. I hadn't been in church since I was 13 years old. I was taken to Sunday school when I was a kid at the little Methodist church in our community. But in all the time I was there, nobody ever one time took the Bible and showed me how to be saved. I didn't know how to be saved. I didn't know about the cross. I didn't know about the empty tomb. I didn't know about anything. But I'll tell you what happened one night. Well, let me just say this. I'll drop it right there and just say, at the age of 20, I was ignorantly lost. I didn't know how to be saved. But let me show you something. I want you to see not only a straying sheep, but I want you to see a seeking shepherd. Mm-hmm. Now, I want you, if you read it, you'll find that he left the 99 and he went out looking for that one lost sheep. Amen. Now, I don't know what that does for you, but that does something for me, because there was a time in my life when I was that one lost, amen.
Yes, sir.
And the thing is, when Jesus, the sweet shepherd, found me. Amen.
Amen.
Now, there are a lot of people talk about finding the Lord, and I guess that's partly true, but I was lost, and I'm going to tell you, when I got saved, I wasn't looking for the Lord. Amen. The thing that got me in church was a little old girl I was in love with. Amen. Who later became my wife, my high school sweetheart. And the only reason I was in church is because the week before, I found out that another boy had been in set with her in church, and I decided if anybody's going to set in her with her in church, it's going to be me. Amen. Now you say, well, that was my motive. That's the only reason I was there. But I'll tell you what happened. The sweet shepherd. You know what he did? He came seeking lost sheep.
Right.
And I was that one. And boy, about halfway back on a Sunday night on the left-hand side of the church, the sweet shepherd found me. Amen.
Amen.
Boy, I was so thankful for that night that the sweet shepherd found me. But let me say to you that I was ignorantly lost. Now, there are a lot of people, you say, well, preacher, how could it be? And you might be shocked to know that there are some people out there that don't know how to be saved. Amen.
Right, right.
They've heard a lot of false doctrine through the years, and some people told them that you have to be saved this way or be saved that way. I'll never forget it. It was on a Sunday morning. They were having something, and I was working the midnight shift, and I couldn't be in my own church for some reason. And so I went to a church where my pastor was at, and I was out of my church. And I went there, and on that Sunday morning, the pastor preached, and a young man responded to the invitation. He came forward, and I was sitting about where you are, and he said, Brother Fred, did you deal with him? And I got down beside him, and I did what most preachers do. I started down the Roman road, and I told him all sin to come short of the glory of God. I started to get to quote the verses, and I said, would you like to receive Jesus? You know what he said to me? He said, I might if I knew who Jesus was. And so I started back again, and I said, you have any problem with the fact you're a sinner? And he said, no. I said, well, God loved you so much. I went to John 3:16, and finally made a profession of faith. But as I talked to the young man, he said, all I remember is they pulled me out of the trunk of a car over around Craigsville, West Virginia. And he said, I don't know who I am, and I don't know where I came from. But he said, I sure am glad that I know Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
And you see, there are some people out there that are ignorant and lost. They don't know how to be saved. And it's a simple thing. And oh, thank God for those that go out seeking lost souls. And Jesus was looking. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. And listen, if you're lost tonight, there's only one way for you to be saved. Let me just put it all out there. If you believe that Jesus died for your sins on the cross and that he was buried and he rose again the third day, if you'll ask Jesus to save you, I'll give you a 100% guarantee he'll save you tonight.
Amen. Amen.
Him that cometh to me, I'll in no wise cast out.
Amen. Amen.
But you find, number one, a straying sheep. You find, number two, a seeking shepherd. I'm so glad the night that the sweet shepherd found me. Amen. But you find, number three, strong shoulders. Now, I love where it says he laid that sheep up on his shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what he did? He carried him all the way home. Amen.
Man, yeah.
And he said, preacher, what does that mean? I got to come out of here. I can't. Oh, yeah. I've stood up here for two nights. I can't stand up there no longer.
Good, come on.
And listen, he laid the sheep up on his shoulders. And you know what he did? He carried him all the way home. Amen.
Amen.
Say, preacher, what does that mean? That means if he starts out with 100 sheep, he's going to make it home with 100.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
Hey, by a lot of people's theology, he would have said, now, little sheep, you follow me and stay as close to me as you can. Amen. And if you make it all the way, you'll make it home. Amen. Amen. But I'm thankful that when I got saved, that he's going to carry me all the way home. Amen.
That's right.
He's taking me all the way there. Hey, it's not nothing I've done or nothing I'll do. It's what he did for me.
Amen. Amen.
Right. And you find out that you find, number one, lost sheep. And the parable of lost sheep teaches us that some men are ignorantly lost, like sheep that can't find their way home. I'm here to tell you that if you're in that condition and you say, well, preacher, I'm just not sure about how to be saved, I want you to know there's only one way to be saved. I love what the brother said. Jesus said it like this: I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me.
Amen.
Only one way to heaven, and his name is Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
But I want you to understand, I want you to look at the second parable, the parable of lost silver. And the parable of lost silver teaches that some men are carelessly lost. Now, when you look at that, I want you to notice some things. It says, either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she loses one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it. Now, for just a moment, let's consider in the parable of the lost silver, the silver. Now, when you think about that, people think about a silver coin. But if you study that passage, you'll find that what it was really part of a wedding headdress. I mean, it signified to a woman that she was a wife. And it had 10 pieces of silver in it, silver coins. And you see, it was the Jewish version of a wedding ring. Now, when I think about that, and I I'd like to say that it was a thing of value. Amen. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many of you have done this, but my wife, she used to routinely lay her rings down somewhere and she couldn't find them. Amen.
Yeah.
And boy, she'd lay that wedding ring and that engagement ring. I see some smiles out there. Amen.
Yeah.
And boy, I don't know how many times I've took the trap out of the sink in the bathroom. Amen. It'd be empty. Nothing in there. And she'd say, oh, I found them. They're laying in the windowsill. Amen. In the kitchen. And I've done it. And the reason I did it was because it was a thing of value.
Right.
And the reason, and you're going to find out that you find number one, the silver, and it was a thing of value. Now, but it was lost. Now, somehow in our day, let me say this. Jesus was speaking about the souls of men. Somehow in our day, we've lost the value of a soul. Right. Amen. Yeah. You know, Jesus said, what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and he lose his own soul? And he said in another place, or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Do you realize that the most valuable thing that you have is your soul?
Right.
Amen. I mean, it's not the house that you live in. It's not the car that you drive.
Right.
It's not the size of your bank account or all of your investments. The most valuable thing that you have is the soul that God gave you. Amen.
Amen.
And I'm here to tell you that somehow we've lost the value of a soul. And if you're here today, regardless of who you are, you have a soul that is going to live forever.
Amen.
Somewhere.
Amen.
It's either going to live in heaven or it's going to live in hell. Amen. But it's going to live eternally somewhere. It's the eternal part of man. This old body's going to die. Someday, if Jesus doesn't come, remember, I got the bases covered. Someday, if Jesus doesn't come, this old body's going to die, and it's going to rest somewhere in the grave. But, oh, thank God for that eternal soul that goes back to the one who gave it, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And today, the most valuable thing you have is a soul. And we need to get back, Brother Jeff, to the fact where we believe that the souls of men are eternal.
Amen.
And we believe in the lostness of man.
Yep, amen.
I remember being in the seminary classroom, and Dr. Lee Robertson was teaching the class at the time. And, you know, Brother Robertson had already retired from the church, but he was still teaching at Tennessee Temple in the college, and he had an old arthritic finger. His finger was like this. I'll never forget it. And I was sitting at a table like this, and men on both sides, and old Dr. Robertson came up, and he shook that old arthritic finger under my nose, and he said, I wonder, do we really believe in the lostness of men? And sometimes I wonder, Brother Jeff, as we say we do, but do we really believe in the lostness of men?
Amen.
Do we really believe that the souls of men are going to live somewhere eternally, either in heaven or in hell? Listen, that's easy to, if you're saved, you're going to live in heaven. If you're lost, when you die, you're going to live forever in hell. Amen.
Amen.
But you see, not only the silver, but you see the search. Now you're going to find out that this woman, the Bible said she searched diligently. I mean, she lit a candle and she got the broom. I mean, I can see her. She takes the candle and she searches out every place in the house. I mean, she goes to every corner and she sweeps and she looks. I imagine that probably she went to the bed and placed the candle on the floor and got down. I remember my mama. I'd be in bed asleep, and on Friday night, my mama always cleaned, and she had an old dust mop, and we had hardwood floors, and she'd come in there, and I'd be laying in the bed asleep, and mama would bring that old dust mop in there and sweep under the bed while I was laying there, amen? She thought I was asleep, but that always woke me up. But I can imagine that little old woman taking the broom and going to every corner, sweeping every inch of the house, and she searched diligently till she found it, amen? Now, let me say this. There are some people that are being lost carelessly. There are some people that are falling through the cracks. And you know what we've done? We've given up the search.
Right.
Yeah.
Bless you, Fred. Amen.
I want to share something with you.
Amen.
A few years ago, I had the opportunity and privilege to be in a revival meeting with Dr. Dolphus Price. I don't know how many of you ever heard of Dr. Price, but he's a great preacher. And we're in that meeting. I went every night of the meeting, and I was pastoring the church, so I couldn't go on Wednesday night. It was another church. And so he said, I'm going to preach tomorrow night. And he gave the title of his sermon. And boy, I wanted to hear it, but I couldn't, so I got the tape cassette of it. But he gave an illustration in that sermon. And he said, I was sitting in my office on the backside of Missionary Ridge. He said, I got a call on the phone, and it was a little mother. And she said, Charlie is lost. And she said, I don't know how we're going to find him. Dr. Price got on the phone, and he started calling people in his congregation. And one by one, the men came out of the steel mill and they gathered at the church. And they got a plan together. They said, we're going to go out and search for Charlie. And said, we're going to take our shotguns, and if you find him, you fire two shots up in the air. And so they left there that night, or that evening, they started to search. He said, along about 2 o'clock in the morning, they started coming back in one by one. He said, they came in, and coffee was already ready in the fellowship hall. They put the shotguns up in the corner. And he said, about 5 a.m., they were all in there. He said, there's no use, we can't find him. Now, Charlie, by the way, I didn't tell you this, he was about 10 years old, and he had the mind of about a 3-year-old. And they said, preach, it's no use. So they decided they'd all go home, and they opened up. He said they opened up the door to that little fellowship hall. Down in the bottom of one of those little drawers, they heard a voice, and it said, Charlie! Charlie! And it was that boy's mother. She hadn't given up the search.
Right.
Her boy was lost.
Right.
But she was determined that she was going to find him. One by one, those men picked up the shotguns and they went right back out. About 2 o'clock that day, they found Charlie. Charlie had enough that he covered up in leaves. And they found what they were looking for. Now, let me say something to you. All over these hills and hollows.
Right.
There are people that are lost.
Amen.
There are people that don't know Jesus Christ.
Yep.
Hey, in this little woman was looking in her own house. Some of these people that are lost, they might be right there inside your house. Wouldn't it be a shame if someone in your house, someone in your family were carelessly lost? And sometimes we lose the value of a soul and we get to the place where we get content and we don't think about it. But listen, there are people out there all over the place that are lost. People that need Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And you see, you find the parable of the lost sheep. Some men are ignorantly lost. They just can't find it. They don't know the way home.
Right.
Some men are carelessly lost. They need someone that'll go out on the search and just keep looking.
Amen.
Till you find them. You know they're out there. I remember getting a call from one of my church members, and she said, would you go see my brother? I said, I will. I knew the man. And I played football, and he was a manager of the team. And so I had a little bit of something in common, and I went down and made small talk, and we talked about old times. And finally, I said to him, there's something I came to talk to you about. He said, I've been waiting for somebody to tell me. And he received Jesus Christ as his Savior and got saved.
Amen.
But whether you know it or not, there are people out here that are like that.
Amen.
People out there that are lost, that need somebody that'll just care enough to keep looking till they find them. Some men are ignorantly lost and some men are carelessly lost, but let me give you the last thing. You have the parable of the lost son. Now, I know that I'm a Baptist. I've always been a Baptist. And by the way, don't accuse me of believing something that I don't believe. I believe in the eternal security of the believer. We'd say amen right there.
Amen. Amen.
But I don't build my doctrine on the parable. And that verse says, my son was dead and is alive again. And it says, and he was lost and is found. Now, when you look at the parable of the lost son, you find out that it teaches that some men are willfully lost.
Right.
Hey, what do you mean? Well, you're going to find out that there's a few movements in the parable. Number one, there's rebellion. I mean, the younger son came to the father and said, give me the portion of good that falls unto me. He said, I want my inheritance now.
Right.
And he was going to leave home. He got tired of the father's house, he got tired of the rules, he got tired of trying to be obedient, so he said, I'm leaving, give me what's coming to me, and he left.
Yeah.
Now, let me say to you, the second movement that you see is ruin.
Right.
Now, rebellion always leads to ruin. Amen?
Right, amen.
When you rebel against everything that you've ever been taught and decide you're going to have your own way, you'll always end up in the far country away from God. And the Bible says he found himself in one. He went out there and, oh, he wasted his father's hard-earned money with riotous living. Had a good time for a while. All the time that he had money, he had plenty of friends. Amen?
Yeah.
You're going to find out that money will make you a lot of friends. But when the money runs out, amen? The Bible said he found himself in want.
Yeah.
And there he is. He got a job feeding pigs. Now, that's a job no self-respecting Jewish boy would ever want. Amen? But he decided that's all I can get. And he went out and to the hog pen and he took the husk.
Yeah, yeah.
Fain he would have eaten the husk. That's just fine, did he? Hey, listen. I mean, I can imagine him sitting. Now, I don't know if you've ever been around the hog pen. That's not the, that's a smelly place, amen. I mean, he was right down there in the swill. That old hog trough. Face down. He was so hungry, them husks was looking good, amen.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, the Bible said, I love what the verse says. And when he came to himself, hey, there's rebellion, there's ruin, there's repentance.
Yeah.
He came to himself. Now, hey, somebody has talked about the insanity of sin. Now, wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if all of those people who were raised in the Father's house would suddenly come to themselves? Amen.
Amen.
Well, the greatest revivals in the history of the church would take place if all those prodigals would finally come to the stuff. But he came to himself and he said, hey man, the servants in my father's house have got it better than this.
Yeah.
He said, I'll arise and I'll go to my father and I'll say unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me. Now you notice, he started out, Father, give me. Mm-hmm. Now he's to the place where he's saying, Father, make me. Now, you always know that something's going on when you can go from give me to make me. Amen.
Yeah.
He said, make me as one of thy hired servants. Now, when you look at it, you're going to find out that there's rebellion. There's ruin. There's repentance. There's return. He's back where he should have been all along. I want to say something about him. I'm not going to labor the point. I'm just going to say this. The lost son was willfully lost.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He wasn't ignorantly lost.
That's right.
Because he knew the way home.
Right.
He wasn't carelessly lost. Because there was a loving father that was waiting right there for him.
Right. Right.
Well, when I look at that, I think about the Bible said that when that old boy started down the driveway. Well, Papa was looking.
Amen.
I believe probably he'd been out there looking. I remember being in this auditorium of the Highland Park Baptist Church, and it was in a presentation of the prodigal son. Boy, that father was up on the stage, and he was looking, and the light flashed out over that 6,500 seat auditorium, and finally it concentrated on something back, and there was somebody on a crutch hobbling down through there, and the father ran off the stage and ran down and kissed his son. Now, I want to say this to you. Listen closely. If you're here tonight and you know how to be saved, if you're here tonight and you know that there's somebody that cares for you, I want you to know you're lost because you want to be.
Mm-hmm.
You're willfully lost. You can't blame it on anybody else. You're not ignorantly lost. You know how to be saved. You're not carelessly lost because you're sitting right here tonight. Somebody invited you to this place. But you're lost because you want to be. You're willfully lost.
Let's pray.
And you see, why did Jesus receive sinners and eat with them? Because just like lost sheep, some men are ignorantly lost. And just like lost silver, some men are carelessly lost. And just like the lost son, some men are willfully lost. If you're ignorantly lost, you say, well, preacher, I didn't really know how to be saved.
All you have to do is believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved.
Amen. Amen.
Believe that he died for your sins, rose again the third day. If you realize you're a sinner and ask him to save you, he'll save you. You're not going to, hey, listen, you're an informed sinner now. Hey, you're not carelessly lost, because right here, I want to tell you, you've got a loving Heavenly Father who's waiting for you to come tonight and receive Jesus as you say. But tonight, there's one thing you can't do anything about. If you're here and you're lost, and you realize those two things, then you're willfully lost. You're lost because you want to be. You're lost because you choose to be. And I wish you'd come tonight and receive Jesus as your Savior. Bow your heads with me if you would. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Now I'm going to ask the question I've been asking. This is not a trick question. I'm not asking because there's some people here I don't know. I've asked this question every night of the meeting. I'm going to ask a question only you and God know the answer to. How many of you are here tonight and say, I'm saved and I know that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to go to heaven and be with him. And you raise your hand high as a witness for Jesus. I'm saved and I know it. Hey, I like that two hands back there. Amen. I'm saved and I know it. You can take it down. Now listen to me. There's some of you here tonight can raise your hand and say you're saved. I can say without hesitation, God wants to save you. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Why don't you come tonight and trust Christ as your Savior? Why are you putting it off? Hey, you have no hope, really, of another day. You say, well, I'll wait till tomorrow. Well, tomorrow might not ever come. Mm-hmm. Why don't you come today and receive Jesus? Our Heavenly Father, as I come to you this evening, I've done all I can. I preached your word. Father, I believe that Jesus did all he could when he died on the cross. And Lord, I believe the Holy Spirit's done all he could tonight. He spoke to hearts. There's only one thing left undone. That's what some lost soul needs to do tonight. I pray, God, that you'd speak. I pray, God, that you'd draw. I pray, God, that you'd have your way. I ask it in Jesus' name for his sake. And amen.